Good morning. Welcome to Jesus the Rock Church. We're back in studying the book of Acts. We're going to begin in chapter 7 here. It's a beautiful sunny morning again. We are absolutely blessed to have this view. The river in the background and the woods. Good old New England. And we got the birds singing. Hopefully you can hear all those birds singing. So we'll begin in chapter 7, verse 1. We left off the end of verse 6 where Stephen, they sat in the council looking steadfastly on him, saw his face as it had been the face of an angel. So chapter 7, verse 1, then said the high priest, "Are these things so?" And he said, "Men, brethren, and fathers, hearken, the God of glory appeared unto our fathers Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia, before he dwelt in Charan. And he said unto him, Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred, and come into the land which I shall show thee. Verse 4. Then came he out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Charan, and from thence, when his father was dead, he removed him into this land wherein he now dwells." So, Abraham had to get away from the paganism, the idol worship, and go out into the wilderness. And now, the people, the Israelites, are now dwelling. Verse 5. And he gave him none inheritance in it. No, not so much as to set his foot on. Yet he promised that he would give it to him for a possession, and to his seed after him, when as yet he had no child. So this was a promise to Abraham, promise of land, promise of an heir for a seed. Verse 6, and God spoke on this wise, that his seed should sojourn in the strange land, and that they should bring them into bondage, and entreat them evil 400 years. So this is a promise that's going to last 400 years or more. We'll learn more about this as we continue. And the nation to whom they shall be in bondage will I judge, said God, and after that shall they come forth and serve me in this place. And he gave him the covenant of circumcision. And so Abraham begot Isaac and circumcised him on the eighth day. Circumcising a male on the eighth day is very, very important. And now medical studies have shown that a baby male child on the eighth day will feel no pain. After them, then the seventh day, the ninth day, absolutely a lot of pain. But on the eighth day, there will be no pain. And Isaac begot Jacob, and Jacob begot the 12 patriarchs. And the patriarchs, moved with envy, sold Joseph into Egypt, but God was with him. Brothers and sisters, is God with you? Do you know that God is with you? I pray that he is. Verse 10. And delivered him out of all of his afflictions. See, we are going to suffer afflictions every single day. But God promises he will deliver you out of your afflictions. And gave him favor and wisdom in the sight of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. See, God wants to give you favor. But we must act according to scriptures. And he made him governor over Egypt and all his house. Now there came a dearth over all the land of Egypt and Canaan, and great affliction, and our fathers found no substance. Okay, so now there's a drought, and now there's no food. Okay? So, verse 12, and when Jacob heard that there was corn in Egypt, he sent out our fathers first. And at the second time, Joseph was made known to his brethren, and Joseph's kindred was made unto Pharaoh. Then sent Joseph and called his father Jacob to him, and all his kindred, 75 souls. So you can read about more about this in Deuteronomy 10:22. So Jacob went down into Egypt and died, he and our fathers, and were carried over into Shechem, and laid in the sepulcher, into the grave, that Abraham bought for a sum of money of the sons of Emor, the father of Shechem. I'm sorry. But when the time of the promise drew nigh, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt. So, ladies were having offspring, children, and they were being multiplied very quickly. Verse 18, till another king arose, which knew not Joseph. 19, the same dealt subtly with our kindred, and evil entreated our fathers, so that they cast out their young children to the end that they might not live, in which time Moses was born, and was exceedingly fair, and nourished up in his father's house 3 months. And when he had cast out, Pharaoh's daughter took him up, and nourished him for her own son. So this is the favor of the Lord. Moses, the Hebrew child, all the children were supposed to be murdered. The mother set them in a basket of reeds and pitch. And he floated downstream to Pharaoh's daughter, found a baby floating, took him up and took him as her own to raise up in the king's house. Verse 22, and Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and was mighty in words and in deeds. This is more favor on Moses, that child, a Hebrew child, with favor and wisdom, knowledge. And when he was full 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. So all this time, 40 years, being raised and trained up as an Egyptian, Scripture says it came into his heart from 40 years old to go and visit his brethren. Verse 24. And seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended him and avenged him that was oppressed and smote the Egyptian. So here Moses murdered someone. Alright, murder is a capital offense. And today many people struggle, well, I killed someone, how could God forgive me? We'll read on. God can forgive you. All you have to do is ask forgiveness. Verse 25, for he supposed his brethren would have understood how that God, by his hand, would deliver them, but they understood not. They didn't have spiritual eyes. They didn't see that now was the time that God was going to deliver them out of bondage, out of slavery from the Egyptians. Verse 26, and the next day he showed himself unto them as they strolled, and would have set them at one again, saying, sirs, ye are brethren, why do you wrong one to another? Verse 27, but he that did his neighbor wrong thrust him away, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge over us? We hear that in the body of Christ all the time now. Who are you to judge me? Alright? We need to have spiritual eyes. We need to have spiritual understanding when God is trying to convict your heart. Alright? God may send a brother or sister to you. Hear what they're saying in love. Not that they're there to judge you or pass judgment on you, but they're trying to correct you in righteousness. Verse 28, wilt thou kill me as thou didst the Egyptian yesterday? So Moses thought, well, he killed the Egyptian, nobody saw him. But now he's finding out somebody did witness what he did. So verse 29, then fled Moses at this saying and was a stranger in the land of Midian, where he begot two sons. And when 40 years were expired, there appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai an angel of the Lord in a flame of fire in a bush. Okay, he was witnessing a bush on fire that wasn't burning, that wasn't being consumed, I should say. The bush was burning, but wasn't being consumed. This is a miracle. When Moses saw it, he wondered at the sight, and as he drew near to it, behold it, the voice of the Lord came unto him. Moses' ears were opened. He could physically hear the Lord speak to him. Brothers and sisters, can you hear God speak to you? See, we serve a living God, okay? A God that can speak, a God that can touch, a God that can feel. Can you hear God? See, a lot of people say, oh, no, you're going insane. You're hearing voices. No. You can actually feel the living God hold you. You can listen to what he has to say, and he will give you revelation knowledge that no one can come up against, which we have read in previous chapters. God is a living God, and he wants you for all eternity, but just got to accept what he did on the cross. Will you ask for forgiveness of your sins? Will you get baptized in the Holy Spirit? Will you do the things Scripture talks about? The forgiveness of sins, water baptism, and baptism of the Holy Spirit. Verse 31, when Moses saw it, he wondered at the sight, and as he drew near to behold it, the voice of the Lord came to him, 32, saying, I am the God of thy fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Then Moses trembled and durst not behold. Then said the Lord to him, put off thy shoes from thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy ground. Brothers and sisters, when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, everywhere you go is holy ground. Claim it that wherever you go, the streets, the highways, the towns, the cities, the nations, the countries, where you go is holy ground. Verse 34, I have seen the affliction of my people which is in Egypt. God himself stated twice, right in a row, I have seen. The God that can see, a God that can speak, a God that can feel. I have seen the affliction of my people. God sees your affliction. God knows exactly what you're going through. Give him a chance to work in your life. Humble yourself before the sight of the Lord. Humble and ask for his help and watch him move in your life. I have seen the affliction of my people, verse 34, which is in Egypt, and I have heard their groanings, and am come down to deliver them. This is 400 years. They've been in bondage. They've been in slavery. But every single day that God has heard their groanings until this day, he has come down to deliver them. This is their day of deliverance. This is the day of their victory. This is the day of their blessing. Brothers and sisters, you will have a day of blessing. You need to have patience. And now come, I will send thee into Egypt. This Moses whom they refused, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge? The same did God send to be a ruler and a deliverer by the hand of the angel which appeared to him in the bush. Verse 36. He brought them out And after that he had shown wonders and signs in the land of Egypt, in the Red Sea, and in the wilderness for 40 years. Signs, miracles, and wonders. This is a constant reoccurring theme in the book of Acts. Signs, miracles, and wonders will follow those who believe. Verse 37. This is that Moses which said unto the children of Israel, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren, like unto me, him shall ye hear. Verse 38. This is he that was in the church in the wilderness with the angel which spoke to him in the Mount Sinai, and with our fathers who received the lively oracle to give unto us. Verse 39. To whom our fathers would not obey, but thrust him from them, and in their hearts turned back again into Egypt, saying unto Aaron, make us gods to go before us. For as for this Moses which brought us out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what is become of him. So they're saying, we lost track of Moses. We don't know what happened to him. Aaron, make us a god to worship. Verse 41. And they made a calf in those days and offered sacrifices unto the idol and rejoiced in the works of their own hands. Now these are the Israelites. These are the Jews. They know they are not supposed to worship idols. But here they go. Strangely, that they just go ahead and ask Aaron to make an idol, and they start worshiping it. Verse 42, then God turned and gave them up to worship the host of heaven, as it is written in the book of the prophets. O ye house of Israel, have you offered to me slain beasts and sacrifices by the space of 40 years in the wilderness? Ye took up the tabernacle of Molech and the star of your god Raphan. Now I could be slaughtering its name. I apologize. I'm doing my best. Raphan figures which you made it to worship them, and I will carry you always beyond Babylon. So he's saying with your idols, you started worshiping Molech, a demon. And the head demon figure, Raphan. Raphan? Okay, so this is not good. Verse 44. Our fathers had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness, as he had appointed, speaking unto Moses that he should make it according to the fashion that he had seen. So Moses had physically seen the tabernacle in heaven, and was told to make the identical replica here on earth. Verse 45. Which also our fathers that came after brought in with Jesus into the possession of the Gentiles, whom God drove out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David. Verse 46. Who found favor before God, and desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. But Solomon built him a house. Howbeit that the Most High dwells not in temples made with hands, as said the prophet. Verse 49. Heaven is my throne, and earth is my footstool. What house would you build me? So God is saying, heaven is my throne. Earth is my footstool. So basically God is putting us in our place. That who do we think we are? You're going to build me a house? Saith the Lord. Or what is the place of my rest? So what is mankind, the created being, going to make that God would find suitable to rest? Verse 50. Has not my hand made all these things? Everything, brothers and sisters, that you can see, smell, taste, and touch is things that God has made. Good morning!
Good morning.
Hey, I have the morning Bible study. We're recording it. Would you like to join us this morning?
We're out for our little stroll. Thank you anyway.
Enjoy the sounds of the bird and the sunshine.
Beautiful day.
Have a nice day, you guys. So, verse 51, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do you. Verse 52, which of these prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the Just One, of whom ye have been now the betrayers and murderers. Verse 53, who have received the law by the disposition of angels and have not kept it. Brothers and sisters, this is a common theme that mankind always transgresses the law of God. But what Jesus Christ has done at the cross, we have a mediator between God and man, the Lord Jesus Christ, for forgiveness, that through his blood we can wash away our sins. Verse 54, when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart, and they were gnashed on him with their teeth. Okay, they gnashed on him with their teeth. Verse 55, but he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. So, after all this witness through the high priest, explaining them everything that has happened for so long over the centuries, he literally even looked up, having the face of an angel, we read about that earlier, in chapter 6, that he had the face of an angel. Now he's looking up into the sky, and he literally can see heaven. And he saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Hallelujah! These are testimonies of the truth, and the truth shall set us free. Verse 56, and said, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. The right hand is the hand of power. 57. Then they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord and cast him out of the city, and they stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet whose name was Saul. And we will get into this more later on. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Now this is a strange thing. He fell asleep. It didn't say he died. See, just before he was stoned by the high priest and elders, he saw heaven opened for him. He beheld the glory of God. Then they grabbed him, dragged him, and they threw him out of the city. And they began stoning him. I don't know about you, brothers and sisters. I was starting to get hit by rocks. I don't know if I could say, Father, please don't hold this sin against them. It's gonna hurt. But scripture doesn't say Stephen died, he fell asleep. Could it be an allegory that he died? Yes. Could it mean that he fell asleep because Stephen is still waiting for the resurrection, for Jesus to come back the second time, and he will be glorified? So he's sleeping until the great final day. We will find out later on, brothers. We will read more we've just learned about a very important character, a young man whose name was Saul in verse 58. Hope you enjoyed this morning. I hope you heard the birds and the planes, people walking by. It is absolutely a blessing to do this video series with you. I just bid you peace. God bless you. May God keep you. Remember, Jesus is Lord. Why? Because He is. Because of His immense love for you. Until next time, peace.